Dear students, your attention is invited to lecture number 2 on the subject of atomic physics. The themes of lecture number 2: photons, particle-like properties of radiation. Three processes, the photoelectric effect, the Compton effect, and pair production, involve the scattering of absorption of radiation in matter. Two processes, Bremsstrahlung and pair annihilation, involve the production of radiation. The photoelectric effect. It was in 1886 and 1887 that Heinrich Hertz performed the experiments that first confirmed the existence of electromagnetic waves and Maxwell's electromagnetic theory of light propagation. It is one of those fascinating and paradoxical facts in the history of science that is the cause of his experiments. Hertz noted the effect that Einstein later used to contradict other aspects of the classical electromagnetic theory. Hertz discovered that an electric discharge between two electrodes occurs more readily when ultraviolet light falls on one of the electrodes. Leonard, following up some experiments of Hollerith, showed soon after that the ultraviolet light facilitates the discharge by causing electrons only emitting from the cathode surface. The ejection of electrons from a surface by the action of light is called the photoelectric effect. It is the phenomenon underlying the operation of the solar cells being developed to convert thermal energy received from the sun directly into electric energy. Figure number 2.1 shows an apparatus used to study the photoelectric effect. A glass envelope encloses the apparatus and evacuating space. Monochromatic light incident through a quartz window falls on the metal plate A and liberates electrons called photoelectrons. The electrons can be detected as a current if they are attracted to the metal cup B by means of potential difference V applied between A and B. The sensitive ammeter G serves to measure this photoelectric current. Curve of a figure 2.2 is a plot of the photoelectric current in apparatus like that on figure 2.1 as a function of the potential difference V. If V is a mate large enough, the photoelectric current reaches a certain limiting saturation value at which all photoelectrons ejected from A and collected by cup B. If V is reversed in sign, the photoelectric current does not immediately drop to zero, which suggests that the electrons are emitted from A with kinetic energy. Some will reach cup B in spite of the fact that the electric field opposes their motion. Figure 2.2 graphs of current I as a function of a potential difference V from data taken with the apparatus on figure 2.1. The applied potential difference V is called positive when the cup B in figure 2.1 is positive with respect to the photoelectric surface A. In curve B, with the incident light, intensity has been reduced to one half that of curve A. The stopping potential V sub zero is independent of light intensity, but the saturation currents I sub A and I sub B are directly proportional to it. However, if this reversed potential difference is made large enough, a value V sub zero called the stopping potential, is reached at which the photoelectric current does drop to zero. This potential difference, V sub zero, multiplied by electron charge, measures the kinetic energy K sub max in the fastest ejected photoelectron, that is K sub max equals E multiplied V sub zero. The quantity K sub max turns out experimentally to be independent of the intensity of the light, as is shown by curve B in figure 2.2, in which the light intensity has been reduced to 1/2 of the value used for obtaining curve A. Figure 2.3 shows the stopping potential V sub 0 as a function of frequency of the light incident on sodium. Note that there is a definite cutoff frequency nu sub 0 below which no photoelectric effect occurs. These data were taken in 1914 by Millikan, whose painstaking work on the photoelectric effect won him the Nobel Prize in 1923. Because the photoelectric effect for visible or near-visible light is largely a surface phenomenon, it is necessary in the experiments to avoid oxide films, grease or the surface contaminants. There are three major features on the photoelectric effect that cannot be explained in terms of the classical wave theory of light. First, wave theory requires that the oscillation electric vector E of the light wave increase in amplitude as the intensity of the light beam is increased. Since the force applied to the electron is E multiplied E, this suggests that the kinetic energy of the photoelectrons should also increase as the light beam is made more intense. However, figure 2.2 shows that the K sub max, which equals E multiplied V sub 0, is independent of light intensity. This has been tested over a range of intensities of 10 to 7 power second. According to the wave theory, the photoelectric effect should occur for any frequency of the light, provided only that the light is intense enough to give the energy needed to eject the photoelectrons. However, figure 2.3 shows that there exists for each surface a characteristic cutoff frequency nu sub 0. For frequencies less than nu sub 0, the photoelectric effect does not occur, no matter how intense the illumination. Third, if the energy acquired by the photoelectron is absorbed from the wave incident on the metal plate, the effective target area for an electron in the metal is limited and probably not much more than a circle having about an atomic diameter. In the classical theory, the light energy is uniformly described over the wave front. Thus, if the light is feeble enough, there should be a measurable time lag, which we shall estimate in example 2.1, between the time when light starts to impinge on the surface and the ejection of the photoelectron. During this interval, the electron should be absorbing energy from the beam until it has accumulated enough to escape. However, no detectable time lag has ever been measured. The disagreement is particularly striking when the photoelectric substance is a gas. Under these circumstances, collective absorption mechanisms can be ruled out, and the energy of the emitted photoelectron must certainly be soaked out on the light beam by a single atom or molecule. Example 2.1, a potassium plate in place at 1 meter from a feeble light source whose power is 1 watt equals 1 joule 2 second. Assume that an ejected photoelectron may collect its energy from a circular area on the plate whose radius r is, say, 1 atomic radius. R approximately equal 1 multiplied 10 to minus 10 meter. The energy required to remove an electron through the potassium surface is about 2.1 electron volt equals 3.4 multiplied 10 to minus 19 joule. How long would it take for such a target to absorb this much energy from the light source? Assume the light energy to be spread uniformly over the wave front. The charged area is P multiplied R squared equals P multiplied 10 to minus 20 meter squared. The area of a 1 meter sphere centered on the source is 4P multiplied 1 meter squared equals 4P multiplied meter squared. Thus, if the source radiates uniformly in all directions, i.e. if the energy is uniformly distributed over spherical wave fronts spreading out from the source, in agreement with classical theory, the rate R at which energy falls on the target is given by R equals 2.5 multiplied 10 to minus 21 joule per second. Assuming that this power is absorbed, we will calculate the time required for the electron to acquire enough energy to escape. We find T equals approximately 2 minutes. Of course, we could modify the preceding picture to reduce the calculated time by assuming a larger effective target area. The most favorable assumption that energy is transferred by a resonance process from light wave to electron leads to a target area of lambda square, where lambda is the wavelength of the light, but we would still obtain a finite time lag which is well within our ability to measure experimentally. For ultraviolet light of lambda equals 100 angstrom, for example, T approximately equals 10 minus second squared second. However, no time lag has been detected under any circumstance. The early experiments setting at upper limit of 10 to minus 9 seconds or any such possible delay. Einstein quantum theory of the photoelectric effect. In 1905, Einstein called into question the classical theory of light, proposed a new theory, and cited the photoelectric effect as one application that could test which theory was correct. This was many years before Millikan's work, but Einstein was influenced by Leonard's experiment. As we have maintained, Planck originally restricted his concept of energy quantization to the radiating electron in the walls of a blackbody cavity. Planck believed that electromagnetic energy, once radiated, spreads through space like water waves spread through water. Einstein proposed instead that radiant energy is quantized into concentrated bundles which later came to be called photons. Einstein argued that the well-known optical experiments on interference in diffraction of electromagnetic radiation had been performed only as situations involving very large numbers of photons. These experiments would result with our sub-averages to the behaviors of the individual photons. The presence of photons is not apparent in there any more than the presence of individual droplets on water is apparent in a fine spray from a garden hose, if the number of droplets is very high. Of course, The interference in diffraction experiments definitely show that the photons do not travel from where they are emitted to where they are absorbed in the simple ways that classical particles, like water droplets, do. They travel like classical waves in the sense that the calculations based on the way such waves propagate, and in particular the way two component waves reinforce or nullify each other depending on their relative phases, correctly explain measurements of the average way photons travel. Einstein focused his attention not on the familiar wavelength way radiation propagates, but on what he first realized in the particle-like way it is emitted and absorbed. He reasoned that the Planck requirement that the energy content of the electromagnetic waves of frequency nu in a radiant source, e.g. an ultraviolet light source in a photoelectric experiment, can be only 0 or h multiplied nu or 2 multiplied h multiplied nu or n multiplied h multiplied nu, implies that the process of going from energy state n multiplied h multiplied nu to energy state n minus 1 multiplied h multiplied nu, the source would emit a discrete burst of the electromagnetic energy of energy content h nu. Einstein assumed that such a bundle energy is initially localized in a small volume of space and that it remains localized as it moves away from the source with velocity c. He assumed that the energy content E of the bundle of photon is related to its frequency nu by the equation E equals h multiplied nu. He also assumed that in the photoelectric process, one photon is completely absorbed by one electron in the photocathode. When the electron is emitted from the surface of the metal, its kinetic energy will be k equals h nu minus w, where h nu is the energy of the absorbed incident photon and nu and the w is the work required to remove the electron from the metal. This work is needed to overcome the attractive fields of the atoms in the surface and losses of kinetic energy due to internal collisions of the electron. Some electrons are bound more tightly than others. Some lose energy in collisions on the way out. In the case of loosest binding and to no internal losses, the photoelectron will emit with the maximum kinetic energy K submax. Hence, K submax equals h nu minus W sub zero, where W sub zero a characteristic energy of the metal called the work function is the minimum energy needed by an electron to pass through the metal surface and escape of attractive forces that normally bind the electron to the metal. Consider now Einstein photon hypothesis meets the three objections raised against the wave theory interpretation of the photoelectric effect. As for objection 1, first, the lack of the dependence of K submax of the intensity of illumination, there is complete agreement to the photon theory with experiment. Objection 2, the existence of a cutoff frequency is removed at once by 2.4 equation. If K submax equals 0, we have H multiplied nu sub 0 equals W 0 sub 0, which asserts that the photon of frequency nu sub 0 has just enough energy to eject the photoelectrons and none extra to appear as kinetic energy. If the frequency is reduced below nu sub 0, the individual photons, no matter how many of them there are, that is, no matter how intense the illumination, will not have enough energy individually to eject photoelectrons. Objection 3. The absence of a time lag is eliminated in the photon theory because the required energy is supplied in concentrated bundles. It is not spread uniformly over a large area. If there is any elimination of all incident on the cathode, then there will be at least one photon that hits it. This photon will be immediately absorbed by some atom, leading to the immediate emission of a photoelectron. Let us rewrite Einstein's photoelectronic equation 2.4 by substituting is multiplied V sub 0 for K sub max for 2.1 equation. This yields V sub 0 equals H multiplied nu divided E minus W sub 0 multiplied E. Thus, Einstein's theory predicts a linear relationship between the stopping potential V sub 0 and the frequency nu, in complete agreement with experimental results as shown in figure 2.3. The slope of the experimental curve in the figure should be H divided E, or using that data from the figure, H divided E equals 4.0 multiplied 10 to minus 15 volts multiplied second. We can find H by multiplying this ratio by the electronic change E. Thus, H equals 4.0 multiplied 10 minus 15 volt second multiplied 1.6 multiplied 10 to minus 19 coulomb equals 6.4 multiplied 10 to minus 34 joule multiplied second. From a much more careful analysis of this and other data, including data taken with lithium surfaces, Millikan found the value H equals 6.5057 multiplied 10 to minus 34 joule second, with accuracy of about 0.5%. This early measurement was a good agreement with value of H derived by the Planck's radiation formula. The numerical agreement of two determinations of H using completely different phenomena and theories is striking. A modern value of H deduced from the previous experiments is H equals 6.6262 multiplied 10 to minus 34 joule multiplied second. To quote Millikan, the photoelectric effect furnished a proof which is quite independent of the facts of blackbody radiation, of the correctness of the fundamental assumption of the quantum theory, namely the assumption of a discontinuous or explosive emission of the energy absorbed by the electronic constituents of atoms from waves. It materializes, so to speak, the quantity H discovered by Planck through the study of blackbody radiation, and gives us a confidence inspired by no other type of phenomenon that the primary physical conception underlying Planck's work corresponds to reality. Example 2.2 deduces the work function for sodium from figure 2.3. The intersection of the straight line in figure 2.3 with the horizontal axis is the cutoff frequency nu sub 0 equals 5.6 multiplied 10 to 14 second. Substituting this into 2.5 equation give us W sub 0 equals H multiplied nu sub 0 equals 6.63 multiplied 10 to minus 34 joule second multiplied 5.6 multiplied 10 to 14 divided second equals 2.3 electron volt. The same value is obtained from figure 2.3 as the magnitude of the intercept of the extended line with the vertical axis. For most conductor metals, the value of the work function is the order of a few electron volts. It is same as the work function for thermionic emission from these metals. In 1921, Einstein received the Nobel Prize for predicting theoretically the law of the photoelectric effect. Before Millikan's complete experimental validation of this law in 1914, Einstein was recommended to membership in the Prussian Academy of Sciences by Planck and others. Their early negative attitude towards the photon hypothesis is revealed in their signed affidavit, praising Einstein, in which they wrote, "Summing up, you may say that there is hardly one among the great problems in which modern physics is so rich to which Einstein has not made an important contribution, that he may have sometimes missed the target in the speculations, as for example in his hypothesis of light quanta photons, cannot really be held too much against him, for it is not possible to introduce fundamentally new ideas, even in the most exact sciences, without actually taking a risk." Today, the photon hypothesis is used throughout the electromagnetic spectrum, not only in the light region, see figure 2.4. A microwave cavity, for example, can be said to contain photons. At lambda equals 10 cm, a typical microwave wavelength, the photon energy can be computed as above to be 1.20 multiplied 10 to minus 5 electron volt. This energy is much too low to eject photoelectrons from metal surface. For X-rays or for energetic gamma rays, such as are emitted from radioactive nuclei, the photon energy may be 10 to 6 electron volts or higher. Such photons can eject electrons bound deep in heavy atoms by energies of the order of 10 to 5 electron volts. The photons in the visible region of the electromagnetic spectrum are not energetic and no, do not tie this. The photoelectrons which they eject being so-called conduction electrons, which are bound to the metal by energies of only a few electron volts. Notice that the photons are absorbed in the photoelectric process. This requires the electrons to be bound to atoms or solids, for a truly free electron cannot absorb a photon and conserve both total relativistic energy and momentum in the process. We must have a bound electron, therefore the binding forces serving to transmit momentum to the atom or solid. Due to the large mass of atom or solid compared to the electron, the system can absorb a large amount of momentum without acquiring a significant amount of energy. Our photoelectric energy equation remains valid. The effects are possible only because there is a heavy recoiling particle in addition to ejected. The Compton effect. The corpuscular particle-like nature of radiation received dramatic confirmation in 1923 from the experiments of Compton. He allowed a beam of X-rays or sharply defined wavelengths to fall on a graphite target as shown in figure 2.5. For various angles of scattering, he measured the intensity of the scattered X-rays as a function of their wavelengths. Figure 2.6 shows his experimental results. We see that also the incident beam consists essentially a single wavelength lambda. The scattered X-rays have intensity peaks to a two wavelengths. One of them is the same as the incident wavelength, and other lambda prime being larger by an amount delta lambda. This so-called Compton shift, delta lambda equals lambda prime minus lambda, varies with the angle at which the scattered X-rays are observed. The presence of scattered wavelengths lambda prime cannot be understood if the incident X-radiation is regarded as a classical electromagnetic wave. In the classical model, the oscillation electric field vector in the incident wave of frequency nu acts on the free electrons in the scattering target and sets them oscillating at the same frequency. These oscillating electrons, like charges surging back and forth in the small radio transmitting antenna, radiate electromagnetic waves that again have the same frequency nu. Hence, in the classical picture, the scattered wave should have the same frequency nu and the same wavelength lambda as the incident wave. Compton and independently Debye interpreted his experimental results by postulating that the incoming X-ray beam was not a wave of frequency lambda nu, but a collection of photons, each of energy E equals h nu, h multiplied nu, and that these photons collided with free electrons in the scattering target as a collision between billiard balls. The momentum of photon can be evaluated from the general relation between the total relativistic energy E, momentum P, and the red mass M sub zero. This is E squared equals C squared multiplied P squared plus mu sub zero C squared. For photon, the second term on the right zero, and we have P equals E divided C equals H multiplied mu divided C, or P equals H divided lambda, where lambda equals C divided mu is the wavelength of electromagnetic radiation that the photon comprises. It is quite interesting to note that Maxwell's classical wave theory of electromagnetic radiation also leads to an equation P equals E divided C, with P representing the momentum content per unit volume of radiation and E representing its energy content per unit volume. Now, the frequency nu is the scattered radiation was observed to be independent of the material in the foil. This implies that the scattering does not involve entire atoms. Compton assumed that the scattering was due to the collisions between the photon and individual electron in the target. He also assumed that the electrons participating in these scattering processes are free and initially stationary. Some a priori justification of this assumption can be found from the considering the fact that the energy of X-ray photon is several orders of magnitude greater than the energy of ultraviolet photon. And from our discussion of the photoelectric effect, it is apparent that the energy of an ultraviolet photon is comparable to the minimum energy with which an electron is bound in the metal. Consider then the collision between a photon and a free stationary electron as in figure 2.7. The diagram of the left, a photon of total relativistic energy E sub zero and momentum P sub zero, is incident on a stationary electron of rest mass energy M sub zero multiplied C square. In the diagram of the right, the photon is scattered at the angle theta and moves off with the total relativistic energy E sub 1 and momentum P sub 1, while the electron recoils at the angle phi with kinetic energy K and momentum P. Compton applied the conservation of momentum and total relativistic energy to this collision problem. Relativistic equations are used since the photon always moves at relativistic velocities and the recoiling electron does too under most circumstances. Momentum conservation requires squaring these equations, we obtain next equation. Adding, we find equation 2.9. Conservation of total radiative energy requires E sub 0 plus M sub 0 multiplied C squared equals E sub 1 plus K plus M sub 0 multiplied C squared. Thus, E sub 0 minus E sub 1 equals K. According to 2.7 equation, this is C multiplied P sub 0 minus P sub 1 equals K. Equation 2.10. Writing K plus M sub 0 multiplied C squared for E in the 2.6 equation, that equation becomes, which simplifies to next, or this equation. Evaluating P squared from 2.9 equations and K from 2.10 equation, we have next equation, which reduces it to next, or 1 divided P sub 1 minus 1 divided P sub 0 equals 1 divided M sub 0 multiplied C multiplied 1 minus theta cosinus. Multiplying through by H and applying 2.8 equation, we obtain the Compton equation. Delta lambda equals lambda sub 1 minus lambda minus sub lambda sub 0 equals lambda sub C multiplied 1 minus cosine theta, where lambda sub C equals approximately 0.0243 angstrom. It is so called Compton wavelength. Notice that the delta lambda, the Compton shift, depends only on the scattering angle theta and not on the initial wavelength lambda. Equation 2.11 predicts the experimentally observed Compton shifts of figure 2.6 to within the experimental limits of accuracy. Subsequent experiments by Compton, Simon, Wilson, Botte, Mazet, Geiger and Blass detected the recoil electron in the process, showed it in a period simultaneously with the scattered X-ray, and confirmed quantitatively the predicted electron energy and direction of scattering.